Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. This show is all about context. That's why I do these rambling intro segments. And this week, I think the tech news deserves a double dose. Case in point, there are plenty of media outlets congratulating good guy AMD for making the bold choice to focus on entry and mid-level gaming GPUs for the next generation. But I have a slightly more cynical take. Intel seems to have pushed their Arrow Lake desktop launch back, and to that I say, well done. And despite the price hike to $700 for the newly announced PS5 Pro, I'd hesitate to dunk on console gamers too boldly. A misfired meme could easily cause damage to our own tempered glass side panels. But above all, contextually speaking, I wanted to take a moment to shamelessly promote that Paul's Hardware channel memberships are now open. Completely optional, of course, but also, if you like the tech news, and you'd like some midweek updates, I will be adding some shorts to my content supply as well. Oh, and there's new merch. There's new merch in the store. We went ahead and added the top three colors in the classic thumbscrew shirt as voted on a couple months back. And check it out, the long-awaited gaming desk mats available in a variety of colors and a couple different sizes. These actually turned out really nicely. Hooray! And now back to your regularly scheduled tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair 3500X mid-tower computer case, featuring an elegant wraparound glass view with removable front and side panels, providing access to a spacious interior that supports up to EATX motherboards. It's also compatible with ASUS and MSI reverse connection motherboards for a clean build, includes convenient cable routing features, and accommodates up to 10 120mm fans with 360mm radiator support at the top and side. For more on the Corsair 3500X, click the sponsor link in the video description. What the GPU market needs is more competition, which is why I was a bit surprised to see so many positive responses to the Radeon news that dropped at the beginning of the week via a Tom's Hardware interview with AMD's Senior VP and GM of Computing and Graphics, Jack Huhn. At an IFA Q&A last week, Jack was quoted at length discussing plans for the upcoming series of GPUs based on RDNA 4, and he made it clear that AMD is not planning to produce high-end consumer gaming GPUs this time around that might compete with the likes of Nvidia's RTX 4090 or 4080 Super. So to be clear, I don't think Jack was lying when he said that AMD would rather bring GPUs to market that fit the needs of the ballpark 80% of consumers who buy GPUs in the budget or mid-range. I'm only suggesting that he wasn't being 100% forthright in explaining the reasoning and motivation that led AMD's top brass to this decision. It is true that gaining market share from Nvidia will help AMD on the development side, and it's also true that from a PR perspective, making it look like you'd prefer to magnanimously serve the needs of less fortunate gamers out there versus the landed elite is a nice way to polish things. But it is also true that, like Nvidia, AMD is increasingly catering to a new market, data centers and AI farms, which has changed their business model and strategy. Now, I wouldn't go so far as to say that AMD is now really a data center first company or anything like that. I will let AMD CEO Lisa Su say that, which she did at the Goldman Sachs Communicopia and Technology Conference on Monday. So, despite further rumors of the supposed Radeon RX 8000 series lineup trickling out, per BenchLife rumors, there are four SKUs in the works, two based on Navi 44 and two based on Navi 48. The likelihood that these will put any pressure on Nvidia's top-end RTX cards does not seem very likely. What I think is quite likely is that AMD is prioritizing development, manufacturing, and packaging of their data center and AI chips, as alluded to by Dr. Su, in order to chase the much higher profit margins that those products command. And The Verge of all outlets is in agreement with me. AMD is turning its back on flagship gaming GPUs to chase AI first. A second Tom's Hardware IFA interview late last week discussed AMD plans that we'll be a bit more forgiving about. UDNA is the new name for a unified graphics architecture that AMD will be developing starting at least with Gen 6, which will now be known as UDNA 6, UDNA 7, and so forth, after RDNA 4 and possibly RDNA 5 have come and gone. AMD originally forked their GPU design in 2019, separating the consumer GPU-focused RDNA architecture from the CDNA architecture used in Instinct data center GPUs. Turns out they made some mistakes on the RDNA side, per VP Jack, and they now see reunifying the two architectures to be the strategic path forward in order to properly compete with Nvidia's CUDA ecosystem, hopefully. Eventually. Jack didn't specify when UDNA would debut, so it's still possible that it could be revealed with their 5th gen GPU architecture design, but getting back to that base concept that more GPU competition would be good on a variety of levels, we wish AMD the best of luck with UDNA. And we wish Intel the best of luck in getting the US government to cut them a check. Turns out that $8.5 billion or so in subsidies that were promised to Intel as part of the CHIPS Act have not yet been dispersed, and per Bloomberg, nobody is happy about it. Intel has been facing a litany of problems in recent months, as discussed on previous episodes of Tech News, and certainly an $8.5 billion cash infusion would help in some ways. The US government, however, is keen to show some results from the CHIPS Act and wants to make sure Intel doesn't nix or cut back on any of the ongoing projects in Arizona, New Mexico, Oregon, or Ohio once their funds are deposited. The US Commerce Department is justifiably dubious given Intel's recent struggles, but at the same time, Intel has reportedly been hesitant to provide certain information to the feds, which doesn't help the vetting process. Considering that the CHIPS Act was supposed to provide more jobs alongside revitalized domestic chip fabrication facilities, it's also not a good look that Intel, one of the top recipients of funds, is in the process of laying off 15,000 plus employees. On top of the $8.5 billion earmarked for Team Blue, they're also eligible for $11 billion in low-interest loans and a 25% tax credit for up to $100 billion. All they gotta do is build those fabs. Then maybe they can take US Department of Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo's advice and start making chips for the likes of Apple and Nvidia. But perhaps Intel should take that advice too, though. As mentioned last week, their upcoming Arrow Lake S processors are not going to be produced by Intel fabs, but rather by a third party, and there's very little chance that it's anyone other than Taiwanese chip manufacturer TSMC. It does seem that Arrow Lake S is on the way, though, and while Intel still hasn't announced a launch date, the rumor mill seems pretty convinced that they'll be available on October 24th. There was an earlier rumor that they'd launch on October 17th, but it sounds like we'll hear an official announcement on Thursday, October 10th, and then the launch on the 24th. Three CPU SKUs are expected initially, the flagship 24-core Core Ultra 9 285K, the 20-core Core Ultra 7 265K and KF, and the 14-core Core Ultra 5 245K and KF, as well as new Z890 series motherboards with the new LGA 1851 socket. And thankfully, we won't have to figure out if we want a DDR4 or DDR5 version this time around. Non-K and T-series CPUs are expected to be announced at CES 2025 in January, and if you hadn't noticed already, Arrow Lake S CPUs have lower peak frequency and no hyper-threading, but some leaked benchmarks still show them outperforming 14th-gen CPUs. But perhaps the best feature of these 15th-gen processors is that they're not 13th or 14th-gen CPUs with a history of instability and failure. That is, if we are believing Intel when they say the new lineup won't have those problems, and they took an extra week to launch them, and we should say, that's okay, Intel, take your time and do the launch right. But maybe that's why they didn't go for a 6 GHz plus moonshot this time around. Speaking of things that are supposed to be faster, it's time to close with a handful of tech briefs. Sony announced the PS5 Pro on Tuesday, which goes up for sale November 7th and will cost 700 USD, or gibbips as they say in England, or 800 euros, or 120,000 Ys with an equals sign through them. It's a mid-gen refresh that promises to achieve higher frame rates at better resolutions than the OG 2020 PS5, and it has a 2 TB SSD, although it lacks an optical drive. Specs-wise, the 60 compute unit setup of the 5 Pro seems to be roughly on par with an RX 7800 XT desktop graphics card, though a lack of Infinity cache could slow it down by comparison. But one thing is for sure, a new console announcement cued an avalanche of PC Master Race memes from the esteemed subreddit of the same name. But I caution you, my friends, console hardware is always less expensive than PC hardware, as they typically subsidize it and lose money up front that is earned back via game sales and subscriptions. So let's avoid the memes that punch down and focus on those commonalities with our console gaming brethren that can bring us all together to complain about how stuff costs too much. For my next tech brief segment, I forgot to write a script, so I'm gonna wing it. We have AMD X870E and X870 motherboards that seem like they will hit the retail market very soon. Videocards.com expects them in late September. A few retail listings have started to pop up, and unfortunately the theme so far is that all of these cost way too much. Granted, we're looking at UK and Eurozone pricing, and this is a compiled list from a few different retailers who posted listings, and we're also dealing with exchange rates and stuff like that, so these are preliminary and to be taken with a grain of salt. Unfortunately though, X870 motherboards that have about half the I/O of X870E, and about half the I/O of X670 for that matter, seem to be starting around $300, and climbing up from there with the peak range for the ASUS ROG Crosshair X870e Hero being $600 to $750. That's a lot of money, and we haven't heard too much more about a 9800X 3D launching anytime soon, so who knows at this point if these motherboards are going to be launching by themselves or with any kind of supplemental CPU launch from AMD to help push along some sales. One thing that everyone seems to like about the AM4 platform and now AM5 though is that you don't have to upgrade your motherboard, so we'll see how sales actually go. But hey, if you need some more spending money to afford an X870 motherboard, why not do what Michael Smith, 52-year-old from Cornelius, North Carolina, has been doing since 2018, earning over $10 million by allegedly using AI to create hundreds of thousands of songs that were uploaded to streaming services like Spotify, Apple Music, and Amazon Music, and then using AI bots to listen to those songs in order to earn a small commission. Those commissions add up when your bots listen to 661,440 streams per day, but Smith apparently didn't keep a low enough profile, as he was indicted by the Department of Justice, who called his setup a brazen fraud scheme. Smith now faces a maximum of 20 years per charge, wire fraud conspiracy, wire fraud, and money laundering conspiracy, so perhaps he should work on an AI-generated lawyer bot to defend himself in court next. The songs and band names that Smith used were auto-generated nonsense like Calm Identity and Zygotic Washstands, and while we might make light of such proceedings, consider the most disappointed victims in this whole fiasco. Zygotic Washstands superfans who were hoping to see them live. I guess the tour is now canceled. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and don't forget to check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, as well as new mouse mats and some new shirts. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.